Y'all, it is MVP time. We are nearing that point in the season with just 2 weeks remaining. Will Nikola Jokic be able to continue to do enough to secure his third MVP in the last four seasons? And the Denver Nuggets, they beat the Cleveland Cavaliers. We're going to talk a little bit of how they were able to do that, what they can maybe look forward to for the rest of the season. And they take on the San Antonio Spurs tonight at home. Can they stack another win to continue to keep pace with the top of the Western Conference? Y'all know what time it is. Let's get it. Locked on Nuggets.
You are Locked On Nuggets, your daily Denver Nuggets podcast. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
What's going on, y'all? Welcome to Locked On Nuggets. This is your host, Swiper. This is your team every day. So glad that you are here with us on this fine, fine Tuesday, y'all. Shout out, happy April to everybody. This is going to be an incredible month of basketball, y'all. The Denver Nuggets, man, they're taking on the San Antonio Spurs, and this is going to be a really, really good game, y'all. But we got to talk about Nikola Jokic and his MVP case. Today's episode is brought to you by Game Time. So download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off your first purchase. Yo. Yes, sir. What's going on, y'all? The Denver Nuggets, they get a win versus the Cleveland Cavaliers, and Nikola Jokic puts up one of the craziest stat lines you'll see, not since Oscar Robertson level stat line, 26, 18, and 16. 26, 18, and 16, and he continues to put up one of the best seasons of his career, and he really continues to put a stamp on the MVP race as it stands. So, y'all, if you currently look at Basketball Reference and you look at the current 2023-2024 NBA MVP award tracker, Nikola Jokic is leading the award tracker with a 51.3% probability that he ends up being the MVP of the NBA. A 51.3% probability that he ends up winning the MVP. And now if you look also at FanDuel.com, he is a minus 600 betting favorite. Minus 600 betting favorite to win the NBA MVP award. Luka Doncic has surged past Shai Gilgeous-Alexander and Giannis Antetokounmpo to be a plus 550. And then you have Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, who's a plus 1800. And then Giannis Antetokounmpo and Jason Tatum are both tied at plus 10,000. So right now, Jokic is the clear favorite. He is the overwhelming favorite per the betting odds, per NBA award tracker on Basketball Reference. He's also the overwhelming favorite. Next up on that list is Luka Doncic with a 14.8% probability. And then you got Giannis with 12.5. And then Shai Gilgeous-Alexander with 10.9. And then you get Jason Tatum at 5. And to round out the top 10, Domantas Sabonis is at 6. Anthony Davis is at 7. Devin Booker at 8. Jalen Brunson is sitting with less than 1% chance, along with Devin Booker at 9. And then Rudy Gobert is number 10 on this list. So one of the things is that the Denver Nuggets have been playing lights out. They have been absolutely out of their minds since they came around after the All-Star break. The Denver Nuggets are 16-4 since the All-Star break, an 80% win percentage. They are, in a net rating, they're a plus 9.4 net rating since the All-Star break, with a 109.9 defensive rating, which ranks 6th in the NBA since the All-Star break. And then offensively, with a 119.3 offensive rating. That's the second best offense behind the Boston Celtics at 126.9. So the Nuggets have been cooking. Their effective field goal percentage shows that their offense has been humming. Their third in effective field goal percentage at 57.8. True shooting, their third as well in 60.4. And a lot of this has to do, obviously, with Nikola Jokic. A lot of this has to do with Nikola Jokic. Now, we know if you're in Denver and you've watched him play at all, we know Nikola Jokic is the best player in Denver Nuggets franchise history. Many people obviously feel last year that Nikola Jokic was robbed of an opportunity to win his third straight MVP. There are a lot of really non-basketball-led narratives that led to that, including many basketball conversations of, is Nikola Jokic even considered a consensus top five player? How did Joker keep winning MVPs when people think players like Kevin Durant or Joel Embiid or Giannis Antetokounmpo or Steph Curry or LeBron James are all better than him? That was the conversation around him. And so Joker last year, got penalized for things that had nothing to do with the sport. And then so when you get to this point, they're kind of like, and I said this going into the season, and some of you might have heard me say this, I said this is going to be the easiest MVP award that Jokic wins over the course of his career. Now, I think he's going to win four. Now, I've said this. I think that he's just one of those players that's going to get there. But if you just look at the way the conversation has gone, Embiid, when he played the first 34 games of this year, was obviously playing incredible. You know, he was averaging 35, 10, and 6. He was playmaking at a high level. He was shooting at a high level. And he was playing really well. And I don't want to take anything away from that. He was playing really well. No, the chance of him sustaining that, obviously, was just not very high, given the fact that how much he was playing, how well he was playing. And then, obviously, he suffered an injury. But he's soon to come back from. So, obviously, the NBA is better with a healthy Embiid. But Joker, remember, Joker went from starting off really well, where it was like, man, he's kind of coming out with a mission. But then, remember, Joker had like that 10 or 12 game sample size. That 10 or 12 game sample size where Joker basically averaged like 25, 12, and 10. And he was shooting like 80% from the field. Like 80% from the field. And if you remember this streak, the shooting percentages that Joker was putting up were literally unheard of. So, y'all, so from December 28th to the New York Knicks game on 125, so basically a month worth of basketball, Joker shot 100% on 11 shots, 90% on 10 shots, 86% on 7 shots, 81% on 16 shots, 68% on 19 shots, 67%, and then 89%, 65, 92, 55, 63, 75, 68, and 72. So remember, Joker had that streak this year when he absolutely just dominated the competition, and he was playing the most efficient, high-scoring basketball of any player ever. And then on top of this, the fact that Joker's averaging 26, 12, and 9 and doing this at a 65 true shooting and doing this while being 61% effective field goal percentage, I believe. Now, his shot has kind of gone up and down as the year has kind of progressed, some of it due to the wrist injury. But his defense has been really good this year. You know, one of the reasons why the Nuggets are a top 10 defense and have been a top 6 defense since the All-Star break is because of the big man in the middle. You know, his ability to deflect passes, his ability to get in the way of what's happening on the court. And again, you know, he had a 6 steal game versus Toronto not too long ago. Like, Joker on the year is averaging 1.3 steals and a block a game. I mean, he's averaging 2.3 stocks a game. And again, this is not for a player that's known as a defender per se. And then he's been one of the best pick and roll defenders in the league this year. He's shooting 35% from three, which is about his average for the course of his career. But then he's also shooting 82.3% from the line with 61 double doubles and 23 triple doubles. And so sometimes, you know, a lot of people mention that, you know, Joker, it feels like some fan bases say it feels like he's not having any impact stories on the year. And I think sometimes we just get really bored with how dominant the best players in the world are and how dominant people are when they're in a locked in situation where they're just knowing what they're supposed to do on a consistent basis. And I think the level of engagement that Joker continues to have and the level of consistency he continues to have, it just goes to show that people really sweep under the rug just how good he is and some of these high level performances he's had. Because again, like, I think a lot of it is Joker doesn't do a lot of talking. He doesn't self-promote. But if you just even look at some of the recent games, Joker 26, 18, and 6, 16, 32, 10, and 5, 22, 9, and 10, 29, 11, and 8, 30, 14, and 11, 35, 16, and 2. And then the 16, 11, and 7, obviously the bad game versus the Mavs, 31, 7, 7, and 5, 12, 14, and 6, 35, 17, and 12. And in that 35, 17, and 12 game with 6 steals and shot 54% from the field. So, and then again, it's the Boston games too. Joker versus Boston in Denver, 32, 12, and 11 with 2 steals. And in that game also had 0 turnovers, 11 and 19. He was a plus 9 in the game that I believe they won by 6 points. And they're playing versus the second best defense in the NBA, and he was 10 for 10 at the free throw line. So I think a lot of people just sometimes like, get really lost in well, it feels like players have higher accumulation numbers and higher raw numbers, which they do. Some of this is just like, but if you just look at the course of the season from the start to the finish and where Joker has been able to land, it's been him or Embiid or him and SGA or him and Giannis and now him and Luka throughout the entire year. And I think for me, that's really important because, you know, when people are talking about like overall impact, one of the things that I think gets dismissed a little bit is Joker is the other name that's consistently been in the MVP conversation. Now, the EPM is going to lean Shai Gilgeous-Alexander this year. Some people are going to vote Shai. You know, he has 50 30-point games this year. He's led the youngest squad in the NBA to the top of the Western Conference. He gets a lot of credit for that. But Jalen Williams has also been exceptional this year. He's been an all-star level player. Chet Holmgren, been an all-star level player. Mark's been an incredible coach, but they have a lot of talent on that roster. There's reasons why they're playing well. And this is not to take away from SGA. This is just a simple matter of the fact of how they got there. They got there because of dominant team play. Joker currently is leading the NBA in PER. Joker, if you look at the overall course of the season, he's fourth in assist percentage, and he's a center. Joker's doing very well in the steal department as well. Joker's usage isn't leading at the top of the league. And in win shares per 48, Nikola Jokic on the season is currently sitting at 0.297, which leads the NBA. And he has 15.4 win shares on the year, which also leads the NBA. He's leading the NBA in box plus minus. He's leading the NBA in BORP, which is value over replacement player. Like, he's just done everything while being mad efficient, just not as efficient as literally the most efficient game of all time, season of all time, when you had him averaging 24.5 points a game on a 70% true shooting. So again, a lot of this is like, it feels that people are kind of wanting another voice, but we did this last year with the Embiid thing, which I think Embiid was incredible, but Joker obviously should have won the award last year. And the playoffs obviously really bore that out, but on the season, he was just unstoppable and unflappable. And this year, Joker has missed three games this year. You know, he's going to miss a couple more because of obviously load managing. But, I mean, he's been just so available this year. And again, Jamal Murray, through no fault of his own, he's missed 20 games. And on top of that, he's been out for another three in the first half. And so he's not even been without. He's been without his best running mate for over almost a third of the season. So I just think that sometimes that stuff gets devalued. At this point, it feels like what the MVP race is going to end up being. It's going to end up being Nikola Jokic at one, Luka Doncic at two, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander at three, Giannis Antetokounmpo at a distant four, and then Jason Tatum at a very distant five. But what I think is going to happen is Jokic is going to get a large majority of the first place votes, and then the second place votes are going to be split between Luka and between SGA. Because I think there's people that are still holding on to what SGA has done over the course of the season, even though he's dipped over this last stretch. And there are going to be a lot of people that are looking at, you know, this last 12-game sample size for Luka and saying, well, I think he absolutely deserved to be second behind Joker. So I don't think that's an indictment on anything. I will say that whoever wins the MVP is going to deserve it. Whoever wins the MVP is going to deserve it. All of these players are having spectacular seasons, but I just think that if you look at the whole of the season, and like I said, you know, coming into this year, you know, it was just going to be Joker's award that he was going to have to more than likely lose given how last year went. So we'll see. But y'all, we'll be back on the other side. We're going to talk a little bit about the Cavs game, some takeaways from that. The Denver Nuggets are getting ready to take on the Spurs. Will Jamal Murray be available for this game? We're going to talk a little bit about his standing and maybe how the Nuggets continue to adjust without him being there, and also the upside of getting him rest. We'll be right back here, Locked On Nuggets. Y'all, sometimes we all need the opportunity to get something off of our chest. Big or small, certain things in life can really start to get to us, and it's really important to let that out, especially to someone who's unbiased on our lives. So today, I want to say how I'm really feeling about my own mental health and how we collectively need to continue to get the help that we need to be the very best versions of ourselves. You know, obviously, like I said, this is tax season, it's money season, taking care of business, paying back the federal government, a lot of that stuff. It's a lot of pressure. And then, you know, this is the time of year where you got Father's Day coming up, you got Mother's Day coming up, you got more birthdays coming up, and there might be many people that don't have parents or relatives or loved ones that are around anymore, and so you can get a little gloomy even as the spring is just getting here. So if you feel like you're in a situation where you need to talk to somebody, therapy is different for everyone. Most of us have a lot of bigger problems than our sports team, and it's important to get things off your chest every once in a while. So if you're thinking about starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online. It's designed to be flexible and suited to your schedule. So visit BetterHelp.com/LockedOnNBA and get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/LockedOnNBA. We'll be right back here at Locked On Nuggets. What's going on, y'all? We are back here at Locked On Nuggets. This is your host, Swiper. This is your team every day. Thank y'all so much for being here. While you're here, please give us a like, share, and subscribe. If you're on the YouTube side, if you're on the Apple iTunes side, please like the video, share, but also make sure you give us a 5-star review on the audio side. That way we can get more and more people locked into what we're doing here at Locked On Nuggets and all the great content that we're getting ready to put out. And y'all, the NBA playoffs are right around the corner. Come April 15th, regular season done. Come April 15th, the regular season is done. Now it's winning time. And the Denver Nuggets are continuing to try to find ways to stack wins and take care of business before we get here. So the Denver Nuggets, y'all, in that Cleveland Cavaliers game, going into it, I was not expecting that kind of performance. And the reason was just because the Nuggets had just not looked like they were able to put forth some of the effort that they normally would have over the course of this 20-game stretch since the All-Star break. But they did. And it was a great game defensively from the Nuggets. Held them to 101 points. Donovan Mitchell, who fairly has also been dealing with a lot of injuries. He was 3 of 12 from the field. But shout out to the Nuggets defense for being able to contain him. Darius Garland, 2 of 8 from the field. He had 5 points. They made life very difficult for both of the backcourt players. And I think that's a testament to Reggie Jackson, a testament to KCP, Christian Brown, Peyton Watson, Aaron Gordon. And then Jokic, obviously, in the pick and roll. And what I love about the way the Denver Nuggets play defense is that they want to give you certain shots on the court. They want to take away the three ball. You're not going to get a lot of those when we're playing at our best. But on top of that, what they like to do is, for bigs especially, if you don't have a high-volume scoring big, that's what the Nuggets really thrive against. Like, if you got a big that's, like, not an Embiid, like Embiid is a high, high-level scorer, high-level jump shooter. But Jared Allen, I think it's a really impressive player. But over the course of this game, Jared Allen, he led the Cleveland Cavaliers in shot attempts. Now, he was 9 of 15. That's really good. But the thing is, Jared Allen is shooting those shots from that floater area, which he was hitting. And he was hitting them around the rim. But then when he misses, you can kick the ball off the basket and you can go run. And when the Nuggets are kind of playing at the level they're playing drop, and then you pass the ball back to the big, the Nuggets want the ball to stop there. Because that way you're getting a mid-range shot, a mid-range push shot. And that just doesn't have the same level of impact as, you know, Devin Booker, Donovan Mitchell, Kyrie Irving, Luka Doncic, Steph Curry, when these guards start to get to cooking and they hit step back threes, or now they're putting pressure at the rim or pressure in the middle of your defense and they're kicking the ball out to wide open three-pointer because of the dig and the collapse. And so some of this is you want to make sure that you're getting the least valuable shot on the court, which is what they did to the Miami Heat. Bam Adebayo averaged 21 in that series. Was good. But Bam Adebayo had a 50 true shooting because he wasn't as effective hitting that shot. And so therefore, the more misses you get, we're going on the other end, getting into our action, getting into our shots, and we're delivering the ball into the basket. Now, granted, the Nuggets, they were 21 of 33 from three. So they had the Timberwolves game, which they were terrible from three. They didn't come out with the requisite energy needed in order to get the job done. But then they come out the next game, they hit 64% from three. And KCP has probably his most efficient game as a Denver Nugget. There are a few games he's had in here. This was not the most important game. You know, he had that third quarter versus the Lakers, I think, in game four in the Western Conference Finals. He had the second game versus the Phoenix Suns, where he went crazy, had 21 points, I believe, as well. But this game from KCP was spectacular because he was very good defensively. But he scored 22 points on 10 shots, and he was 6 of 9 from 3. 6 of 9 from 3. That's incredulous. That was incredulous by him. And it wasn't like they were just wide-open spot-up shooters. Wide-open spot-up shooters. The dude literally was moving off DHOs and just getting into an action. Like, he was getting off a transition and hitting threes as well. And I love what I love for KCP. KCP does all the dirty work for the Nuggets. He guards the best player every day. He hustles. He dives on the floor. He finishes in transition. He fights on defense in transition. He fights over screens. He's one of the best off-ball players in the league defensively. Like the job he's done on Steph Curry over the course of the last 2 years. KCP, man, that's the level of effort that he consistently gives on the defensive end. And the Denver Nuggets, man, they would not be the team that they are without that kind of engagement. So a lot of this is like you're glad to see KCP get those looks. Michael Porter also had 19 points and 6 rebounds. Again, he was a plus 18 in that game. KCP, by the way, a plus 35. Jokic, a plus 37. Insanity. Michael Porter, a plus 18 in this game, 19 and 6. And then Aaron Gordon, 8-8 and 5, 3-7 from the field. But Reggie Jackson, what I want to say about Reggie is Reggie has had some moments this year where he has really looked really good. He's looked really good. He's looked confident. He's been able to lean into his skill set really well. And this game in particular, he was 5 of 5 from 3. And when Reggie is in a situation where his body feels good, for instance, and he's able to consistently play into what his skill set is, which is a pull-up shooter, which is off the pick and roll, hitting that floater. And then when he gets open spot-up opportunities, he's been pretty good this year. So I actually am really excited about the turn that he could make towards the playoff, because I've said this before. You know, when you're an older player, which is not old, like he's 33, you know, Reggie and I are the same age. But when you're an older NBA player, sometimes the mileage of the regular season can just be a lot. And when you're playing every night, which he has every single night, and then you're in January and February, or you're in December, sometimes the middle of the season, just not your sweet spot. And March, early in the month, he wasn't looking good as well. But in the last several games, it feels like he's just been able to find a little bit more of his shot-making groove. And that is really big towards the Denver Nuggets. And I've said this before. You know, if Reggie Jackson, if he plays at 80% of what he was this last game, he was 19, 3-3, and he was 6-10 from the field. You ain't got to do that. But if Reggie Jackson in the playoffs, you told me if he averages 13 points a game, he's averaging 2 rebounds a game, he's averaging 4 assists a game, whatever, 3.5 assists, that'd have to be crazy. And he's shooting like 46% from the field, 39% from 3, and 81% from the line. As your backup point guard, then you love it. Then you love it. So I think Reggie has that capability, and I think he can provide some of that consistency, but he's just going to need to be healthy, be locked in and engaged. And Reggie was able to do that, so really shout out to him for that game. And Christian Brown, by the way, y'all, 28 minutes played, 10, 6, and 1. He was 4 of 8 from the field. 4 of 8 from the field. 2 of 3 from 3. 1 block, 1 steal, and he was a plus 26. And this is also another point. Christian Brown and Peyton Watson, between the two, 19 points, 9 rebounds, and 3 assists. 19 points, 9 rebounds, and 3 assists. If you also can get that, that's another layer. That's how they continue to make these strides forward as young players off the bench, especially because their defense is going to be critical. Now, I do think Justin Holiday is going to see minutes in the playoffs. He's just too good of a shooter, too much of a pro. His defense is also a plus. And I, you know, we talked about this a little bit, but you know, when you're 6'6", you got that level of athleticism and engagement. That's, I think, is going to be really good for your long-term prognosis for the rest of the season for this Denver Nuggets squad. But y'all, on the other side, we're going to talk about the Denver Nuggets playing versus the San Antonio Spurs. They're going to have another game at home. Victor Wembanyama has been playing incredible lately, but the Nuggets might have some answers for that. And we'll talk about, does Jamal Murray make an appearance today, or does he continue to sit out to continue to make sure that he's ready and fully ready by the time he comes back this NBA season? We're going to talk about all that and more here at Locked On Nuggets. Yeah, I love going to concerts. I love going to comedy shows. I love going to events. But y'all, sometimes it is such a hassle to get where you want to go and to find tickets that take advantage of, you know, pricing, seating, all that stuff. But y'all, Game Time is such a great app to get involved with because you save up to 60% off from buying last-minute sports, concert, comedy, or theater tickets. So take the guesswork out of buying tickets for Game Time. All you got to do is download the Game Time app, you create an account, and use code LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off your first purchase. And again, you can see where the seat is located. You can see the price of the seat. And then if you also see a price somewhere they can price match some stuff for you. Like, Game Time is such a great place to lean into. Now it's MLB season two. You want to go to a Rockies game. You want to go to a Dodgers game. You want to go to an Astros game, wherever it might be. This is the app to you. So make sure you download Game Time, download the app, create an account, use code LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account and redeem code LOCKEDONNBA, LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off. Download the Game Time app today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. We'll be right back here on Locked On Nuggets. What's going on, y'all? We are back here at Locked On Nuggets. This is your host, Swiper, your team every day, Locked On Nuggets, y'all. Shout out to y'all. Thank y'all so much for being in here. The chat is full. The people are here watching live. If you're watching this after the fact, miss you. Hope you're having a great day. Y'all, the Denver Nuggets are taking on the San Antonio Spurs, and this is going to be an interesting game. So Jamal Murray has not officially been ruled out of this game. There's no official update that he is out, but his terms, he does not appear. He's not off of the injury report. He's still there. And so Jamal Murray, he's missed the last five games. He's missed the last five games, and he's currently noted on the Denver Nuggets injury report as questionable with right knee inflammation. Nikola Jokic is probable with left hip inflammation, right wrist inflammation, and then Aaron Gordon, right foot strain. So Jokic and Gordon, they could be more than likely locked in and ready to go. I don't know if Jamal Murray plays. I don't know if this is the game that you need to bring Jamal Murray back for sure. And the reason is, it's like, look, the Spurs are a very young team, and they're playing really well. But if you look at their report, they got Vassell's on the injury report, Sohan's on the injury report, and Keldon Johnson is on the injury report. So Victor Wembanyama is going to play. And y'all, the Nuggets are currently, they're a minus 16-point favorite. They're a minus 16-point favorite tonight versus this team, which I think is very telling in that how the betting sites are viewing this game. But y'all, if you haven't seen Victor Wembanyama, y'all, that dude, that young man is incredible. He is incredible. This dude is averaging 21, 10.5, and 3.6 assists on the season so far. And the last five games for him, 32 points, 40 points, 19, 13, and 31. That's insanity. And he's already one of the five best defensive players in the NBA, if not a little bit higher, just depending on, you know, where he is and his age and everything. But he just has been able to, like, make leaps and bounds progression on the year. And, again, 21, 10.5, and three blocks a game. And he's averaging 3.4 blocks a game, 1.3 steals a game. He's a rookie. He's averaging five stocks a game with 10.5 rebounds. He's shooting 47% from the field, 32% from three, and 79.9% from the line with 39 double-doubles. Last five games, 27 points, 11.6 rebounds, 5.4 assist, 2.6 blocks, 1.6 steals. And he's shooting from the free throw line, 75% from the line, 32% from three, and 51% from the field. I truly think that by the time we get to the end of next year, he is going to be in top 10 player in the world conversations. Top 10 players in the world conversation. And so this is going to be a really interesting fight for the Nuggets because they just beat the Knicks. And Jalen Brunson, on 47 shots, had 60 points in that game. Had 60 points in that game. So the Nuggets are going to need to come out and play hard, but they just need to play Denver Nuggets basketball. And I don't think Jamal Murray is necessarily needed for this game, so I actually would not expect him to play. Can they play versus the Clippers on Thursday? And then they play versus the Hawks at Ball Arena on Saturday, and then they have the Jazz, and then they have the Timberwolves, the Spurs, and the Grizzlies. This is just not a game that they need to have Jamal Murray back for. So what I will say, I think Reggie Jackson gets to start today. If Jokic and Gordon end up playing, I'm going to say the Denver Nuggets are going to win this pretty handily. They should win by about 14 points or so. This could end up being like a 128, to 112 games, something like that. But I don't know. You know, we'll see how their offense kind of puts together. I'll be a little bit more conservative today. I'm going to say 125 to 110 or 112. 125, 110, 112 for the Denver Nuggets in a win versus Wimby today. But, y'all, that's going to do it here for Locked On Nuggets. Who do you think wins tonight? What are you expecting to see from the Denver Nuggets? Do you expect Jokic to win his third MVP this year? Let me know what you think in the comment section, you all. This is your boy, Swiper. I'll see you on the other side.